his mom had said that he had a stroke. So he was in the hospital. So remember Bob and the needs there. Any others tonight? Springs, he's still irregular heartbeat, different things that's going on. Changed her medicine, but that dropped it too low, so now they're doing that. So just remember her in prayer. They figure out what's going on. She may end up having to have the heart ablation done, so let's pray that God will touch her, amen, or meet that need there. God's able to do it, amen. Thompson, remember her, she's probably going to rehab. So let's pray. All right, well, let's pray tonight for this service, Brother Rick. Pray for us.
Sunday afternoon, we'll be pulling out, headed to Pigeon Forge to the Arise Conference, and pray much that God will meet the needs, amen, of our young people, all the young people that will be there, expecting God to do some great things,
amen,
touching their hearts and their lives, and I believe God's working in their hearts, amen, and I'm just trusting that the Lord will help them just to surrender their heart to Him, their life to Him, and whatever His will is for them. So you pray for them, amen. Pray for safety as we all travel. Pray that all the vehicles will run good and safe. No flat tires. All those good things, amen. And so we don't want to get stranded on the road, amen.
This is one of the songs the Lord laid on my heart. One of the message pastors preached and was using Hebrews chapter 12 and one of the first.
Talks about running our race with patience, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Think how often, many times in my own life, put your eyes off Jesus.
I'll be a lot better just to keep our eyes on Him. That's what the song is about.
Set on Him the burden of your heart, and you gave for naught. By the time your eyes are drifted, and the ones you look upon as friends have been the ones to break your heart. So look to Him, and He won't ever fail you. Yeah. Nowhere else to turn to find and realize he's the one. So look to him. He won't ever fail you. Look to him. He'll always be there. Give you strength to make it through the darkest night. Take the shattered pieces of your broken life. Give you peace and comfort through your greatest strife. And be your closest friend. Be there with you.
It's one of those songs that you can sing it a little faster up the pace like congregational, or you can sing it slow like I'm gonna do. And still a great song, one of my favorite songs. Victory in Jesus. Oh, victory in Jesus.
You have your Bible tonight?
Turn to the book of Daniel, chapter number 6. Daniel chapter number 6 this evening. Daniel chapter number 6, I will begin reading verse number 12. The Bible says in verse number 12, Daniel chapter number 6, then they came near and spake before the king concerning the king's decree. Hast thou not signed a decree that every man that shall ask a petition of any god or man within 30 days, save thee, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions? The king answered and said, the thing is true, according to the law of the Medes and Persians, which altereth not. Then answered they and said before the king, that Daniel, which is of the children of the captivity of Judah, regardeth not thee, O king, nor the decree that thou hast signed, but maketh his petition 3 times a day. Then the king, when he heard these words, was sore displeased with himself, and set his heart on Daniel to deliver him, and he labored till the going down of the sun to deliver him. Then these men assembled unto the king and said unto the king, know, O king, that the law of the Medes and Persians is that no decree nor statute which the king establisheth may be changed. Then the king commanded, and they brought Daniel and cast him into the den of lions. Now the king spake and said unto Daniel, thy God whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee. And a stone was brought and laid upon the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet and with the signet of his lords, that the purpose might not be changed concerning Daniel. Then the king went to his palace and passed the night fasting. Neither were instruments of music brought before him, and his sleep went from him. Then the king arose very early in the morning, and he went in haste unto the den of lions. When he came to the den, he cried with a lamentable voice unto Daniel. And the king spake and said to Daniel, O Daniel, servant of the living God, is thy God, whom thou servest continually, able to deliver thee from the lions? Then said Daniel unto the king, O king, live forever. My God hath sent his angel and hath shut the lions' mouths, that they have not hurt me. For as much before him innocency was found in me, and also before thee, O king, have I done no hurt. Then was the king exceeding glad for him, and commanded that they should take Daniel up out of the den. So Daniel was taken up out of the den, and no manner of hurt was found upon him, because he believed in his God. And the king commanded, and they brought those men which had accused Daniel, and they cast them into the den of lions, them, their children, and their wives. And the lions had the mastery of them, and brake all their bones in pieces, or ever they came at the bottom of the den. Then King Darius wrote unto all people, nations, and languages that dwell in all the earth, peace be multiplied unto you. I make a decree that in every dominion of my kingdom, men tremble and fear before the God of Daniel, for he is the living God, and steadfast forever, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed, and his dominion shall be even unto the end. He delivereth and rescueth, and he worketh signs and wonders in heaven and in earth, who hath delivered Daniel from the power of the lions. So this Daniel prospered in the reign of Darius and in the reign of Cyrus the Persian. Our Heavenly Father, we're grateful again for the privilege that we have to gather into the house of the Lord on the Lord's day. Thank you, Father, for every blessing that has come our way this day. Thank you, Lord, for just being so good to us. Thank you for everyone here tonight. God, I pray that you might help us this evening as we study this portion of the Word of God.
Father, that our hearts would be open. And Lord, we could gain that which is needful for our lives, to live for Jesus. And Lord, to stand in these days that we are living. Oh, God, we need your touch tonight. We pray for that anointing from heaven. Lord, fill us with thy spirit. Oh, God, that Christ will be honored and magnified. Father, everything that you do, we'll give you the glory and the praise. For God, we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. I want you to notice these verses that we have read here this evening from the book of Daniel. And I want to preach on this thought tonight, a night with the lions. Now, this scene that we have read this evening is probably one of the most familiar texts in the Old Testament. I'm sure that if you went to Sunday school as a child, no doubt you heard about Daniel in the den of lions. And that's a story that the children have taught, we're taught, and we teach our children. And we do that to let them know that the God of heaven is able to deliver us, amen, to take care of us no matter what is going on. And so Daniel's night in the den of lions is another example of God's power and what he can do in the lives of those who serve him. There may be times in your life you may feel like you're in a lion's den or den of lions. But I'm glad the same God that delivered Daniel is the same God that you and I serve tonight and can do the same for us. Aren't you glad this evening that God is no respecter of persons? He doesn't favor Daniel over any of you in this building tonight. I'm glad what he's done in the Old Testament, the great miracles that God did, the great things he did in the New Testament. I'm glad God is still the same God and is able to do for you and I, amen, just like he did for them. In our last study, we looked at verses 1 through 11, and we thought about the testimony of Daniel. We preached about how's our testimony, what kind of testimony do we have. And of course, Daniel had a wonderful testimony, and that is one reason why he was attacked by those that didn't like it, because God had his hand on him. And he had been promoted, and I mean, God was using him. And of course, that brought those that did not like him, amen? And we see that the life that Daniel lived, he lived a contagious life, a consistent life, and a clean life, amen? And God blessed him. Now tonight, as we look at the events of these verses we've read, we see that what God does not always shelter us from adversity. In other words, just because you do everything right, you've got a good testimony, you live right, you do everything right, everything as far as you know, you're right about it, but it does not shield us from troubles. It does not shield us from problems, amen? In other words, God doesn't always stop bad things from happening to good people. But God is always faithful. And so as we see that demonstrated here in the life of Daniel. Just because you go to church, you go every service, you give, you witness, you read your Bible, you pray, you live right and do right. Hey, that doesn't shield you from having bad things that happen in your life. I know we've got a lot of prosperity preachers that say as long as you do right, everything will be wonderful. I got news for you. I ain't found that in the Bible yet. Amen. I found that those that served God, most of them suffered more than anybody did. Amen. But God was faithful to them even as they served the Lord. And so I want you to notice this story tonight as we continue studying here in the book of Daniel. First of all, I want you to notice the deception of the princes. Now, Daniel was given a place of authority only exceeded by the king himself. In other words, Daniel was promoted to second in command. I mean, there was nobody higher than Daniel but the king, amen? And so in verses 1 through 3, it talked about Darius set him over the kingdom and 120 princes, which should be over the whole kingdom, and over these three presidents, of whom Daniel was the first. And so the Bible says that this Daniel was preferred above the presidents and the princes because an excellent spirit was in him And the king thought to set him over the whole realm. In other words, he put Daniel in charge of those three presidents. He was the first one, and he put him in charge of the other two presidents and the 120 princes that were under him. Of course, Daniel's reward for the excellent spirit that was in him was the green-eyed monster of jealousy that happened to those princes under him. Amen. Somebody made this statement. I believe it was Jeff Foxworthy. He said this. He said, "I've never been jealous, not even when my dad finished the fifth grade before I did." Amen. And so these princes, though, they were jealous. I mean, they let that old green-eyed monster of jealousy. No doubt, probably some of them thought, why in the world they bring this foreigner in here? You know, they brought him in from and brought him into captivity, but God blessed him and God used him. And no doubt they're thinking, why would he use that guy there that's not even one of us for real? And here we are, we've lived here, we grew up here, we're homegrown, amen. No doubt they begin to think a lot of things like that. And so they wanted to do anything they could to destroy Daniel. I mean, they set out in their heart to destroy him. Amen. And notice the plan that was staged. These jealous princes tried to find something in Daniel's life that they could discredit him before the king. But they couldn't find anything. Daniel had such a tremendous testimony that they could not find anything that they could discredit Daniel with. And so they said, the only way we're going to be able to find something is if we can find something concerning the law of his God. And so they came up with the plan and this deception they put before the king. And the plan was that all the presidents, the governors, everybody in the realm of Babylon, they would ask no petition of any god or anybody for 30 days except for you, O king. And they said, we want you to sign this decree. And of course, they got the king to sign it, and they did that. The king signed it, and so they did that. And so they began to proclaim it, that for 30 days, nobody could make any petition to any god, to any man, except for the king. Now, they knew this because of the life that Daniel lived. They knew that Daniel could not go very long without praying and seeking the God of heaven. Matter of fact, when they brought the accusation to the king, they said, this man prays three times a day. Amen. They knew what his life, they knew the pattern of his life. And that is what they were going to use to try to discredit him and to tear his life down. And of course, we know that after the decree was signed, the Bible said that Daniel went to his house with his windows open toward Jerusalem, and he began to pray and call upon the God of heaven as he did aforetime. In other words, it didn't change what he believed. It didn't change what he was going to do. He still was going to serve God regardless of the decree of man. You and I tonight, if we're going to really serve God, there may be times we're going to have to go against the decree of man. Amen? And we may suffer for it, but we need to serve God with all of our heart. And so the plan was sprung. The moment Daniel disobeyed the king's decree, and they made a beeline to the king. And boy, they began to tell it all. They said, King, we want you to know, did you not sign this decree that there's no petition to be made of any god or man but thee? And he said, if they do that, he said, they're to be thrown into the den of lions. And the king said, this is true. Amen. Yeah, I did. That's exactly what we did. And so they began to tell him, said, well, that Daniel, isn't that amazing? How they spoke about Daniel. That Daniel. You know that one. That one you set up. Look at what he's doing now. He knew that you had signed a decree. He knew what you had said about no petitions to be made. But that Daniel, which is of the children of the captivity, well, they brought that up. They threw that in the king's face. In other words, he's not one of us anyway, but that Daniel, the one of the captivity, he said, he regardeth not thee, O king, nor the decree that thou hast signed, but maketh his petitions three times a day. Boy, their hatred for Daniel is so obvious. I mean, they're doing anything they can to destroy this man. There was no respect for him. There was nothing but hatred for him. And they referred to him with disdain as one of the children of the captivity of Judah. In other words, they were saying, he's a foreigner. He don't have no part with us, no way. And look what you've done. You promoted him. Now look what he's done. How he's disregarded everything that you've said and the decree that you have made. All of a sudden, the king realized he had been tricked. He had been deceived by these princes. Look at verse number 14. Then the king, when he heard these words, was sore displeased with himself. In other words, he realized then he had messed up. He realized then he had been played like a fiddle, amen? He had great respect for Daniel. I mean, he's the one that put him in second in command. He's the one that appreciated everything that Daniel was and everything that Daniel did, to the point he elevated him, amen? And now he realizes that those men have done nothing more than deceive him to try to destroy Daniel. The actions of these princes remind us of the depths a jealous and spiteful person will go. They had only one goal, and that was to destroy Daniel. Amen. Isn't it amazing how people will lie on other people just to destroy them? Amen. They'll try to do everything they can. And it's sad when they really don't deserve what they're wanting, but they can't stand it because somebody else got it. Daniel, I mean, God was just using Daniel. And God had his hand on Daniel. And Daniel was just being obedient to the Lord and following the Lord. And the king is the one who elevated him to that position. He didn't climb up the ladder himself. Amen. He was brought in. Oh, but isn't it amazing how jealousy and hatred and envy had set out to destroy this one man. One writer said that jealousy is so fatal to those who cherish it, for it will transform the noble into monsters. Amen. Another one said, envy's a coal coming hissing hot from hell. It's turned the princes into monsters. And like a coal hissing hot from hell, Daniel was the object of their jealousy, and they created their plot to have him destroyed. I mean, they didn't want to just have him taken down from being second in command. They wanted him dead. I mean, it's amazing how things get in your heart that will ruin you while you're trying to ruin somebody else. Amen. Not only do we see the deception of the princes, but we also see the distress of the king. Now the king, although he loved and had great respect for Daniel, knew that his princes had put him into a bind. In other words, he had signed a decree that could not be changed. I mean, the law said that once the decree has been signed by the king, that it cannot be changed. And so he knew that he had to go through with what he had signed. And no doubt he'd done everything he could. Matter of fact, the Bible says that when he was sore displeased with himself, I mean, he just couldn't believe that he had been played like that, to be brought into their scheme to destroy this man. But yet now, there he is. We see a fruitless day in verse 14. The Bible also said that he set his heart on Daniel to deliver him. In other words, he was going to try everything he could to get Daniel out of this. He was going to do everything he could to prevent Daniel from having to be cast into the den of lions. Verse 14 says that he labored till the going down of the sun to deliver him. I can imagine the distress that this king was under. He had been played. He has been used to bring murder to an individual. That's all it was going to be, was murder. Amen. And so he'd done everything he could to find out some way to deliver him. I'm sure he probably called all of his legal experts to see if they could find a loophole through which he could deliver Daniel from execution. Maybe there was a precedent that he could be found, that the king allowed the king to reverse a law that had been signed into being, but it was all in vain, because verse number 15 says, then these men assembled unto the king and said unto the king, know, O king, that the law of the Medes and Persians is that no decree nor statute which the king establisheth may be changed. In other words, they brought it up and said, hey, whatever you're trying to do, it can't be changed. You can't do anything. Amen. You've got to do what has been written and signed. Nothing. The king had no choice but to carry out the law that had been enacted with his signature. Verse 16, can you imagine how awful this was? Then the king commanded, and they brought Daniel and cast him into the den of lions. I can imagine that king was all, beside himself, because of he knew he was already sore displeased with himself. He had already been trying to figure a way out of this, but now no way is out. And he's brought Daniel, and they put him into the den of lions. After Daniel was thrown into the den of lions, certain procedures were taken. Verse 17 says, and a stone was brought and laid upon the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet and the signet of his lords, that the purpose might not be changed concerning Daniel. The stone was placed over the den so that Daniel could not escape. No doubt it was a very heavy and large stone, making it impossible for Daniel to move it. Then the king placed his own seal upon that lion's den, guaranteeing that no one else would attempt to free Daniel. The highest crime that one could commit was to break the king's seal. Even the seals of his lords were added as further security. Every step was taken to ensure that Daniel could not be delivered from the fate that awaited him. Nothing could be done. It seemed like his fate was sealed. Not only do we see a fruitless day, but we see a restless night. Look at verse 18. Then the king went to his palace and passed the night fasting. Neither were instruments of music brought before him, and his sleep went from him. I'm sure all of us probably have spent some sleepless nights at times. Something get on your heart, and you can't sleep. Can't get it off your mind, something burden on your heart, and there's no way you can go to sleep. Sometimes you wake up in the night, and boy, God begins to burden you, begin to think about different situations, and you can't go back to sleep, amen. Here the king, he goes to his chamber, and he begins to fast, and that night he didn't even call for any music to be played to try to soothe his spirit. But all that night he spent sleepless. Amen. Matthew Henry says he went to his palace, vexed at himself for what he had done, calling himself unwise and unjust for not adhering to the law of God in nature. He ate no supper but passed the night fasting. His heart was already full of grief and fear. He forbade the music. Nothing is more unpleasing than that song sung to a heavy heart. He went to bed but got no sleep, was full of tossings to and fro till the dawning of the day. Oh, listen, you know the best way to have a good night's sleep is to keep a good conscience, amen. Keep things right, then you can lay down in peace. But that night, oh, the king could not rest. He was displeased with himself. He knew things were not good. And oh, he just wondered what was going to happen to Daniel as he put him in that den of lions. But thank God we see the deliverance of Daniel. I love this. Those men, they wanted Daniel dead. They didn't just want him out of office. They wanted him dead. I mean, I can understand people that would try to, you know, get people moved, but I can't understand people wanting to have people put to death. I mean, now you get that kind of attitude, you're in bad shape. Amen. And may I say, people that get that kind of attitude and thought and all of that in themselves, it will ruin them. It'll ruin them. But notice the deliverance of Daniel. Just before Darius had thrown Daniel into the den of lions, he made this statement. In verse number 16, this is what the king said. Now the king spake and said unto Daniel, thy God, whom thou servest continually, he will deliver thee. I believe that as this king had watched Daniel's life, there's no doubt in my mind that that king began to understand a little bit about the God of heaven. He had seen God deliver before this. Amen. You remember those three Hebrew boys? They put them in the fire, but the fire had no power over them. Matter of fact, the king said, did we not put three into this fire? And they said, yes, king, we sure did. He said, well, I see four. He said, I see four men loose, walking around. He said, the fourth was like the Son of God. And no doubt what he had seen, what he had saw in Daniel's life, the testimony that Daniel lived, all of a sudden he is a believer in the God of heaven. And he believes that the God of heaven can do anything. He said, because Daniel, your God whom you serve continually will deliver thee. Wasn't that a blessing? That God was using Daniel in such a way. He said to Daniel, thy God will deliver thee. Amen. In other words, he probably would have said it like this, Daniel, I've done everything I can to keep this from happening, but I have no choice, but I believe God's able, amen. I believe your God is able to take care of you and deliver you, and amen, that's exactly what he did. Notice his preservation. After rolling and tossing all night, walking the floor, early the next morning, the king goes down to check on Daniel. Verse 19. Bible said, then the king arose very early in the morning, and he went in haste to the den of lions. And when he came to the den, he cried with a lamentable voice unto Daniel. And the king spake and said to Daniel, O Daniel, a servant of the living God, is thy God, whom thou servest continually, able to deliver thee from the lions? That lamentable voice speaks of a voice filled with anguish. A voice that was probably broken as he began to cry out toward Daniel. I'm sure that maybe he believed that God would deliver him, but he also had seen before what lions have done to people that they have thrown into those dens of lions. He knew that nobody has ever escaped the punishment of the lions. And with a lamentable voice, he said, oh, Daniel, is thy God whom thou servest able to deliver thee? Maybe Daniel gave it a minute. The king was maybe thinking, oh, no. But then verse 21, then said Daniel to the king, oh, king, live forever. Well, I bet that's the best thing the king ever heard, to hear the voice of Daniel from the den of lions. Amen. Oh, king, live forever. Verse 22, he says, my God has sent his angel and has shut the mouths of the lions. They have not hurt me, for as much as before him, innocency was found in me, and also before thee, O king, have I done no hurt. In other words, he said, God's been faithful. God realized that I hadn't done nothing wrong, and you hadn't done nothing wrong. It wasn't us that was in doing this. God knew all along what those people were up to. God knew all along what they were trying to do to Daniel and how they used the king. Hey, I got news for us tonight. God knows everything that's going on about my life and your life. And God will take care of us if we'll continue to live for him, serve him, be faithful to him. I believe God will help us even through the times when we're going through troubles. Amen. God is able. God is able. And Daniel says, I'm good. Everything's fine. Verse 23 says, then was the king exceeding glad for him and commanded that they should take Daniel up out of the den. And so Daniel was taken up out of the den. Here's what I like. Look at this. And no manner of hurt was found upon him. I've never been in a den of lions. I have seen lions, but they've always been in cages. I told you about that time we took the kids to Durham to the Museum of Life and Science and took us in there on that little train. Of course, they had to open the fence to get in. Then when we got in, they closed the fence behind us. Got on that little train, they took us around, dropped us off. A few minutes, the train come up. And I said, what's going on? He said, get everybody on the train. I said, everybody get on the train. I said, what's going on? He says, there's a lion on the loose. Get on the train! Amen. As fast as that little train would carry us all out, it carried us all out, and we got it. Hey, I'm glad nobody got hurt, but just knowing that a lion was on the loose, that was enough for me to get out. But can you imagine a den of lions that no doubt had been, food had been withheld from them so that they would make sure that they would rip to pieces whoever or whatever was dropped into that den of lions. But he comes out and says, no, there was no manner of hurt was found upon him. Here's what I like also. Look what it says at the end of that verse. Because he believed in his God. Hallelujah. I believe I'm going to believe God. If believing in God will keep you from the den of lions, I believe we just better believe God. If believing God will keep you through the fires of the furnace, I think we just might as well believe God. Amen. I'm glad believing God will keep us from the fires of an eternal hell. Hallelujah. So I'm just going to believe God. God took care of Daniel in spite of those that wanted to destroy him. Notice his vindication, verse 24. And the king commanded, and they brought those men which had accused Daniel. And they cast them into the den of lions. Notice this, it didn't just affect them. They threw them and their children and their wives. See, everything we do don't just affect us. It affects everybody that is with us. Everything I do affects that little woman right back there. Whether she's got any part of it or not, whatever I do affects her. And whatever I do affects her, not only her, but it'll affect them three girls of mine. It'll affect all them grand youngins I got. It'll affect my mom. It'll affect my whole family. It'll affect people that I have known all my life since I got saved. It will affect a bunch of folks. Same thing with you. Here, it didn't just, this saying, well, it's my life. It's your life, but it don't just affect you. I was thinking about it the other day. I was preaching a funeral. And I talked to another lady this week, and she's forewarned me. She said, would you do a funeral if it has to be? I said, I'll do anything I can. Because the way things are not looking good, and because of choices that people make. Here's what breaks my heart is when you look and all you can see is a mother that has no words. All she's got is tears. And I'm sure that the people that caused that would say, well, it's just my life. But they don't see how it affected mama. Don't see how it affects daddy. Don't see how it affects their siblings. Amen? And these men, maybe they didn't even think about it. They thought they were going to get by with it. They thought, oh, we'll get this done. I guess they thought if we're getting rid of Daniel, we got a shot at it. But they didn't get a shot. The Bible says they cast them into the den of lions with them, their children, their wives, and the lions had the mastery of them. And break all their bones in pieces or they ever came to the bottom of the deep. Matter of fact, according to what the Bible says, as they threw them in, before they could ever hit the ground, the lions had already had their way with them. Broke their bones, tore them to ribbons, killed them. Oh, listen, God delivered Daniel, but he did not deliver those to whom were trying to get rid of Daniel. And then the whole affair resulted in ultimately God getting the praise and the glory for everything. Look at verse 25. Then King Darius wrote unto all people, nations, and languages, that dwell in all the earth. It didn't just affect their little locality. He wrote it to the whole world, to the whole earth, the Bible says, that dwell to unto all people, nations, languages that dwell in all the earth. Peace be multiplied unto you. I make a decree that in every dominion of my kingdom, men tremble in fear before the God of Daniel, for he is the living God and steadfast forever, and his kingdom that which shall not, for he is the living God and steadfast forever, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed, and his dominion shall be even unto the end. He delivereth and rescueth. He worketh signs and wonders in heaven and in earth, who hath delivered Daniel from the power of the lions. You see, God got glory unto all the earth. This one man's life brought glory to God in all the earth. And I do believe that any time that God's people are going through situations in their lives, it's ultimately to bring glory to the Lord. Amen. I mean, what you're going through, you may not understand it, but God is going to use it to help somebody else. We can help others by showing our faith and trusting God, even in the bad times. So many times people get to going through hard times, the first thing they say, I'm quitting. I ain't going back to church no more. What did the church do to you? What did God do to you? God's just helping you to help somebody else. Amen. And the best thing about it is God can bring us through it. The Bible said there was no hurt found on him because he believed in his God. Tonight, that's what we've got to do. Just believe God. When Paul was going through those storms, after he prayed, he came and said, sirs, I believe God. That's what you and I need to do. Let's just trust God. When things are going good, it's easy to trust God, ain't it? When everything's going sour, it's hard. But we've got to keep believing God. Father, tonight I want to thank you again for your word and or the encouragement that we gain for our own lives. Or we look at Daniel and we see the great opposition that he faced. Lord, no doubt it may have been that Daniel had no idea the way these men felt toward him. Oh, until he was arrested and brought to the king. The king delivered him to the den of lions. Did he understand what was going on? Oh, God. Sometimes, Lord, it seems like we're blindsided in our lives, but God, I'm glad that when we're blindsided seemingly, God, you knew all along what was going on. Lord, that you took care of every situation, gave Daniel what he needed. Lord, you'll do the same for us. God, help us, I pray, in these days, to just believe God. In Jesus' name, we pray. While we stand tonight, oh, that's a good song. Just learning to lean on him. Learning to trust God. Easy to trust him when everything's good. It's another thing to trust him when everything's going south. All the troubles are abounding in your life and you don't understand why. I'm glad God does. God knows. There's nothing in the life of a child of God that God is ever unaware of. I'm thankful. I'm just going to believe God. Father, I pray you bless your people tonight. Thank you for everyone here this evening. God, may you help us in this week coming up. God, may our life be used for the honor and the glory of God. Father, everything that's accomplished, we'll give you the praise and the honor and the glory. For we ask it all in the name above all names, the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Appreciate you being here tonight. What a good Lord's Day we've had today here at the church. Looking forward to the week ahead. Pray for the service coming up Wednesday night. Be back with us 7:30 here at the church. Pray for those that are sick among the church, and God will touch them. Pray for those in our families that are lost. folks that have been coming to church that need the Lord, that God will deal with them. You never know through the radio and through the Facebook ministry who God is speaking to. So let's just pray, amen, the Lord's will be done. It's been so good to see you all here tonight, amen. Hope you have a great week this week.